Between the Lines Identity Belonging 2022 Open Mic. Our students have been here all week writing and creating, and we're really excited for everyone to get a chance to hear their work. If you haven't signed up yet, the sign-up is up here. We can pass it back as needed. I'll turn off my phone. There's like $500 back there, so does that sound better?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Again, welcome. We're so excited to hear your work. If you need the open mic sign-up sheet, it's up here. If you would like to perform any kind of duet with a partner, we have two mics. So if that calls to you in any way, please feel free. The only other thing I want to let you all know is that Between Lines Identity Belonging is funded by Doris Duke, Islamic Arts for Building the Bridges program. And we are so lucky to have you guys here with us. And I won't talk for too long and let our first reader go, which is Syriana.
Yes,
okay.
Love it.
So this is a conversation. So I have something I need to tell you.
Need to?
Yeah, well, more like I want to tell you, but I gotta say it, you know? Okay, hit me. So, I've been thinking. You've been thinking. Yeah? Oh no. No, no, oh no, just, I'm just bored, that's all. So I started thinking about stuff. Yeah, like if every day is a moment in our life, then how the hell does our little tiny brains fit in all of those moments, you know? Yeah. What? Well, I'm just thinking. Ha ha. All I'm saying is, are you gonna say it? Or shall I? So, me then? No. No. You don't have to do that. Okay. Right. I just wanna know everything, but I can't. Okay? And I want to control my environment, but I can't. I don't know, though. I don't know. Okay. Do you want to keep talking about it? Yeah.
Thank you so much, Syriana, being the first reader. Is the hardest thing to get out of your kid. Okay, the next reader we have is Lauren.
Okay, hi everyone. This is a piece I wrote today actually in Melody's workshop. So it's fresh, so bear with me. Okay, it's titled, I Didn't Know I Wasn't Joe Biden. I didn't know it wasn't normal to compare yourself to the President of the United States. I was in deep conversation with my therapist, which, knowing me, was probably sparked from talking about college, boys, or social dynamics, and I casually brought up the argument that Joe Biden would know how to solve a problem I was having. My therapist, Megan, has copper ginger pin straight hair and a sternum piercing that is so thin you can barely see it on the underwire of her nose. Its subtlety allows you to miss it at first, especially over the Zoom screen, which I've only known her through. Upon closer inspection, it is quite obvious and adds depth to the once hyper-professional, white-walled office vibe she initially gave off. Megan is taken aback, her nose wrinkling with a sense of concern, but her eyebrows slightly raised as if to say, "Ooh, we found the jackpot." I do not understand her strange look and continue with my monologue of complaints of the week until she interrupts my rambling and demands I repeat what I just said. I don't realize what she's referencing at once, but somehow grasp that she was confused by my presidential logic and repeat my sentence. The president would have been able to do it. And as much as her professionalism once intimidated me, it seems that she cannot hold back her raw emotions now because she lets out a laugh that is so real and so quick that now I am taken aback. I try once again to defend my viewpoint, but Megan shuts me down with a simple counterpoint. You are not the president. Her logic makes sense, but for some reason it takes me months to uninternalize the idea that my accomplishments have to be up to the standards of the President of the United States. A position which, by the way, I've never shown interest in running for, and I've always questioned the effectiveness and morality of. But I'm stubborn, and so is my mind, and so I was set in my ways that I had to be as accomplished and as revered as someone as powerful as the president. This mindset particularly affected me during my years in the highly competitive high school Model UN circuit. Unlike the Model UN shown on television, the Olsen twins signed in Love in London, or Debbie from Never Have I Ever taking shots in her hotel room come to mind, Model UN at my school was life. Conferences were not a time for romance or alcohol. We were there to win, to maintain our school's title as one of the top teams in the country. Now that I'm a little more removed from the intensity of the activity, I realize that the concept of Model UN is high schoolers cosplaying war criminals in hotel basements. But in the heat of the moment, my performance at these conferences determined my entire self-esteem and self-worth. If I gave a good speech, I was on top of the world. If I was not for sponsor, I was an utter failure. The instability and oftentimes unpredictability of Model UN did wonders on my self-worth. Perhaps Model UN's close ties to government systems is what started my habit of comparing myself to government figures like the president. I found myself crying in Hilton hotel bathrooms, asking myself why I wasn't first sponsor on a resolution paper, because I knew that if the president were there, he would have been able to do it. However, my comparisons to questionable figures did not stop at the president. I also spent years of my high school experience. I'm 14 years old, idolizing 17 and 18-year-old high school junior and seniors who I believe to be the closest thing to God on earth. Senior Ananya Asana and junior Omar Siddiqui were the loves of my life, the people I aspired to be like and the people I dreamed of being liked by. If I were on board, I would be successful. And if I were on board, everyone would look up to me. And if I were on board, I would be happy. When the time came for me to actually run for board at the end of my sophomore year, absolute hell rained down on my family. 2 years of shaky self-esteem and placing my entire self-worth on paper awards had culminated into this one moment. The skills I learned from the activity, like public speaking and leadership, meant nothing if I didn't win. I actually opened the election results in therapy, a very full circle moment that I did not plan, and in an act of God, noticed me in validating my work over the past 2 years to get to this point, I won the election. And by winning, I was saved from the horror that would have occurred if the results had been different. But by winning, I was in many ways robbed of an opportunity to learn to handle rejection and loss, which, no worries, was a lesson I would not be spared of in the near future, but that's a story for a different essay. To my surprise, my life did not instantly become better once I was on board. I did not suddenly understand derivatives and multi-integral calculus. My crush is not suddenly enthralled with me. In hindsight, Model UN is not the most sexy extracurricular activity. Instead, all of the insecurities and lack of self-worth and need to be compared to the President of the United States were still as present as ever. I'd achieved Omar and Ananya status, but I was still not enough. The intense pressure I place on myself to be as successful as a 70-year-old white man in the Oval Office is something that apparently is not a widely related experience. But the feelings of never being enough, of never being able to live up to the Ananyas and Omars of your world, is one that at least has floated in the minds of everyone in this room, whether they participated in Model UN or not. And I made progress after months of work with Megan, but sometimes it's beneficial to look in the mirror and remind yourself that you are not Joe Biden. Thank you.
Lily. I'm Lily, and I'm going to be reading something I wrote the other day called The Shovel. The shovel is tired of digging up the dirt, rusted from time, battered with a bent handle and chipped metal. Sometimes there's nothing in the ground, so what's the point in digging? Opening a void just to fill it again with loose, airy dirt, rain still seeps through, so the worms slide back in anyway. And when there's no more dirt, everything else is thrown in there. Old bicycles, broken toys, flat tires, the junk pits are covered up with an old tarp, but it's not secure in the ground and the wind is so strong that the tarp blows away and all the neighbors can see the junk in the holes because of the shovel. And if the shovel is so tired, why doesn't it stop? I think the shovel should be thrown away. And if the shovel is so tired, why doesn't it stop? We can live on minimalist land, no junk, no shovel. As for the holes, maybe we can just sit inside of them and talk. Talk about why the holes are there in the first place and why we keep digging them up. We'll sit and talk in the holes, and it'll take so long that over time the soil will erode. In fact, it'll erode so much that the ground becomes level at the very bottom of the holes, and it'll be like the holes were never there in the first place. And when that happens, maybe the shovel will no longer be a shovel. Maybe the metal was melted and reshaped into a hook on the wall for a little boy's school bag to hang. Or maybe it's a horseshoe for a horse that lives on a farm. I think the farm would be big, with no holes.
Place of sides, a place of differences.
Parties that celebrate conformity, sections are always divided. Doesn't matter where you live, you never win. Your life is never yours. A chessboard of a country, black or white, you lose. No matter cards dealt or number of tokens, you lose. You fight for a can of food like a dog. Go to a job day after day and never care if it works you to death. You need that money to survive. Now open your eyes and realize this world is yours. I am a place of hate and crime and abomination, no matter what you choose. Every fucking thing is mine. Welcome to the system. Enjoy your stay. Hope you don't hate it. I promise you won't. And if you do, there's nothing you can change, because you're powerless in the face of power.
New terrains. A shoe without a lace is still a shoe. A lace without a shoe is a nuisance. It is not valued when intertwined with a shoe. It is useless without the shoe. A lace is never seen. A lace is bunched up, forced into a knot. A lace is frayed. A lace is tripped over. A lace is a danger. A shoe is not a danger. A shoe is in danger. A shoe is stepped on. A shoe steps. Cracked sidewalks, sharp rocks, muddy trails, a shoe endures. The shoe, in danger, is tied by the lace, a danger. They are one, and they are separate, and they will forever be connected. Because the shoe and the lace were stitched, manufactured together. Because the shoe and the lace witnessed the same first roads, first streets, first buildings. Because the shoe held the lace up. Because the lace held the shoe together. Because the shoe and the lace carried each other when the world would not. Thank you.
Perspective of an optimist. The restraints of my arms were made of leather, and a piece seemed to be so uneven that whenever I moved my arm, it was torn by the Velcro, and a mess of raw flesh was left where the skin once was. The unpleasant air was stale and reeked of dried blood. I was only a subject among many, but I was a subject nonetheless. My body was encased in a coffin of leather, only leaving my head. I'm sorry, I should actually mention before I keep going. There is some blood and stuff described. Anyway, my body was encased in a coffin of leather, only leaving my head to gaze out and peer into the cold, lifeless room that seemed to hold lights that were barely capable of functioning. That was when they came. The furry robes moved in droves, killing each other just to have the chance to greet me. Never have I been so popular. They made their way to my residence and used their tiny claws to report the leather in earnest. Almost pleading to enter the tomb with their tiny squeaks and hisses. Success. The pain was sudden and astonishing. My piggies were ripped apart one by one without hesitation, dooming them never to visit the market again. Eyes bulging, I bit down to relieve their pain, only to destroy my molars. Blood gushed down the sides of my teeth and I laughed, spreading the juices around me. I always hated going to the dentist anyway. Hungry little buggers darted to where my spittle was and artfully dug, as if to savor every last mouth-watering bite. I cried for pleasure and pain, sympathizing with them as they tore into my liver. If only they had some onions. Suddenly, my body was cold and my stomach began to churn. I was not nervous. Interestingly enough, the churning was much closer to that of a smoothie in a blender. My only wish was that they would have gotten more of a meal. I never did work out that much. And then this one, to go with the theme, is also about shoes. Pitter-patter, pitter-patter, the beat on the ground, thumping repeatedly, boom, boom, boom. Protecting them from harm, they continue on. The cloth is colorful and beautiful, with an artistic design of fire and fantasy thrown across the side. Oh, beautiful, helpful, glorious shoes. They grow old. Well done, they said. Darkness and stagnation grew more common as time marched forward. Lost and forgotten was the shoe. Radiant moments where they see their master. Then there was no master at all. Another adventure, please, give me another. With every beat, the shoes lose themselves. They lose their purpose, but they don't care. Another moment, another. The shoes reach the pinnacle of jubilation, over and over again. Their last adventure has come, and the shoe serves their purpose. The foot moves forward across the tough green ground, and a distant sound of a ball can be heard. Suddenly, I am ripped into two. My beautiful craftsmanship cannot continue on, and the flame is split into two. The flame has drifted into nothingness, and I have grown apart. I am nothing. My sensation returns. I can feel the wind whisping by, and noise grows. I am now everywhere. I feel the pressure of the grass and the faint scent of feces welcoming the morning dew walk. The warm mush is welcoming as I slowly ease into it. Then I am frantically looked around. The melancholy runs into the powerful precipitation amongst the clouds. I soak it in. Forever ingrained in me is that puddle, that smell, that moment. I fly through the air and create a noise against the wood. Next, a sob. A different salty kind of water landed on me. I soak that in as well. I feel the heat of a body, hopelessness, and kindness. Once again, another, the height of jubilation. I feel a dense cloud and smell of smoke as greenery is exhausted and extinguished. Something beautiful. I am here for you. Pitter-patter, pitter-patter. The beat of myself. The smell of smoke grows stronger and the smell of life grows weaker. I lay there amongst the green and stew, 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 stew. Never hungry, I sit and lay, waiting for my day passion to once again reach jubilation. I fall deeper, deeper than the green, deeper than the soul. Thump, 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 the beat of the forest. Pressure begins to flow, then overflow, magma rising in my belly like a warm stew, life tickling my face like a beautiful and light angel. There is destruction and creation, hunger and fullness, hungry world. I feel drowsy as I move across the ocean, feeling the dolphins kick around inside of me, mischievous creatures constantly lifting, killing, saving, drowning, living. There I am again, on the courts, in the car, on the stage, keep moving, keep going, pitter-patter, pitter-patter, one motion, one movement.
That cannot see. There are so many boulevards, but only two alleyways still standing, plastered patches of once scrap graffiti, gutters littered with needles so soft they almost could have been spring. To grow up on the bridge of everything you wish had been yesterday. In retrospect, I hear slight explosions and they sound like heartbeats. In the steel skyline, we trace our hands into the pavement, promising to be awake forever. But in the afterglow, we carry our bodies to the seaside. We make a birth out of burial, cult-like and auspicious. We steal the embers from our lips and tell tales of revival. Hush, there's something cold on the edges of the New Sea. Signal one, speed is only an antidote to silence. I want to feel the blood, but each flashlight still wants tomorrow. We live through the newsprint from breath to breath. Scorched by fire glow, we steal anger instead of light. Come with me and midnight will open his wings. Our betrayal, a clash of city lights and wire castles. Silhouettes we obliterate to pieces. You tell me there is one lie and it is our bloods contained this moment. Sugar crackling like necroclips of dynamite. To love is to catastrophize, to sin is to bite. Bullseye with the shard of metamorphosis. I'm sorry these words can't be a window, but what more is intensity than a flight we can't swallow, a blur we can't immortalize to life? And the second one is called Emergence, or Self-Portrait as Nightstraw Closet. Open the dresser in the middle of the night and dress your clothes in you. Put the paper lamps of IKEA in the suit pocket, red apple staining bed sheets, Beijing summers and jean shorts, how your grandmother held your hand tighter and asked you to never change. Qipao drenched, pearls untangled, how the aliens never came. A trench coat with a hole past the abdomen, white satin in the dark, how you knot it, how sometimes you still wait for them at endings. Put your mother in the nightgown and make her beautiful, the way we become by choosing to swallow again and again despite urinating. Don't let the finished product look itself in the mirror. Instead, open the shutters and let it tiptoe down the staircase, lips grazing a blue moon. It's so free, it's here. The body open and more radiant in the rain.
About how thankful I am for the childhood experiences they worked to give me. It's called Thank You Faux Verses. When my mom handed you to me, I hid my teary gaze when I realized you were so fake, your thin sides were labelless. But now I stare at the scuffs we made together and I realize, you gave me what my parents couldn't. Thank you Faux Verses for surviving Riddle Street summers after watching the silver wires in my dad's bird nest hair fill the room, so I had no choice but to drown in the waters of his age. Thank you, Faux Verses, for the day I pulled Biggs outside because my weak hands could not shield little man's ears from sharpened words, so we drew dreams of rainbow chalk on your toes. Thank you, Faux Verses, for catching me the day I decided to throw my fist into a brick wall of a boy so that I could prove that I was strong. Thank you, Faux Verses, for letting me crush my Bubba's mint under my heel to step back for me to realize it rose fresh and cool. Thank you, Faux Verses, for letting me scrunch my toes the day Jenny's face turned as fiery as her hair and my brother held the door handle of our busted beige minivan and screamed and shouted about the end of everything. Thank you, Faux Verses, for tucking yourself into my calves on days we spent under a sky of school bags and cubby holes with a book leaving a dent in my knee. Thank you, Faux Verses, for leaving a footprint all your own in the sandbox that forced sticky mouth kids to watch me walk away. Thank you, Faux Verses, for not needing a label so I can give you a name all my own.
As time flies by, the crowd with people following me are now filled with mail and garbage cans. The paranoia isn't the same as it used to be when I was younger. The running home in the dark turned into a slow walk. Basketball under the streetlight became schoolwork beneath the lamp. All the yelling and bad calls are difficult teachers. Long walks with your family are now commentary while you watch TV. Slowly drifting away, looking over papers until your fingers are cut. 5% of your body is band-aids, your face becoming pale, and eyes are hurting from staring at the same screen. You can feel the wrinkles forming, the dark bags under your eyes. Dreaming of a clean slate, taking the wheel and hitting the gas. The only screaming in your ear is the keyboard clacking, closely criticizing the cramped page, forwarding for a fresh set of eyes, staring at the page in frustration, the aggravation that fueled my mind. Blazing past each page until you reach the epilogue, smiling to yourself, thankful for not having a dead end of a job, to change or to not.
Thank You breathe. You demand the particles work. You never understood its worth. You see the particles have a bloody heart. You can't see the bruises. You can't see the force of my thirst. You hold the air, let it into your lungs. You let it pump the salt water of your sorrows without flooding your air ducts. You let me dance down your throat to the throb of your heart. You introduce me to the secrets that burn the flesh of your tongue. You build me a raft to sail along your stream of blood. You turn your oceans of hell into flowers of love. Blow your air out and let me lather your skin. You share me with the sun, sky, and all learned things. You will ignore all the air's power, forget that it's there, until the weight of your burden sparks flames out of thin air. Now you will treasure the air and beg for my breeze. You knew I was there, but didn't ever care. You saw me as a right to keep your ecosystem alive. I saw you as that soil for where my flowers never die. I've accepted that you forget you need me to breathe. You will waste me on monsters and make me fight the smoke filled with insults and pain, but I'll never concede. I give you my pain. I will let all of me sink into your skin because I know what it feels like to suffocate.
Fiona is up next. And I hope you guys aren't like annoyed with me by the end of it, because this is gonna take a bit. So my first is called Sign for the Model Tanks at Kentigny Park Warns of Slippery Surfaces. Because little boys who would have been unbodied in 1918 now monkey bar from machine gun barrels, and Botanic Garden sun killing machines dormant under camouflage green paint remind me of the rubbery swing chain coatings that bombed sticky tween fingers into calluses 3 summers ago. I'm peeling the scab-like bark from a tree when someone says, Daddy, it, the unaliving part, is as long as I am. Boy smiling, Mentos white teeth is measuring how much doughboy still roars with blood ready to grenade itself. He is moistening palms against a painted skull and crossbones. The bark hacks off and cleaves open to a dry, dusty red as he explodes into coke-colored mulch chips, and I imagine his elegy, died for his country with sweaty hands that couldn't hold on. My next piece is called Assimilation. T is an alien with yellow parents who wear ugly glasses and speak their language like angry bees. T is 6. Teeth fall out of her mouth like pistoled English. She says under God and does not mean it. Her parents still work at the restaurants on Sunday. T is 10. No one sits next to her at lunch because she eats stinky food. People call her an infidel because she sneaks out at night to worship communism. T has no PJs for pajama day. People in China don't wear clothes. T is 18. T goes away for college and a white boy prays a bullet into her parents' backs. But T is American now, and she does not complain. But T is Christian now, and fears God so much. My next piece is A Special Kind of Dumpster Fire. Slowly, I am living out a poetry form where everything is secretly on fire like the courtyard dumpsters. Secretly, because upon being asked to take out the trash, I mixed soap water with kerosene, and now it burns fireproof, corrosive paint smoldering up my arms, glowing as if I were God. Forget disintegration. Hear the ashes of a burning high bun, chain smoke in dark alleys. Or broad daylight, because every split second my skin detonates and still nobody else feels it. Noon and I am lying in bed, fingers tapping, counting syllables to the rhythm of dumpsters on fire, and my buns on fire, and myself on fire. Now I tell you, people, bears as battlegrounds, the true form of flame has no warning of smoke or light. It only burns this fever, this fervor of light.
Sarah.
called Growing Pains. I hate waistband scars from too tight jeans, scars that reveal the growth of your hips, your sides pressing out to become the white space between picture books and makeup bags. I can never throw away a pair of too tight jeans because I can never acknowledge that I am growing. Everyone grows. Everyone grows, they say, but what if I'm afraid that my jutting hip bones will disappear and be replaced by startling stares on crowded LA streets? I find that a lot of my jeans end at my calves and squeeze my waist until it folds like a beach chair, there from when I was 10 and 12 and 13. I don't have many new pairs of jeans because I'm scared that by throwing out old, ratty pants, I'm somehow inching toward a war that spreads through flesh that doesn't stop until I no longer exist. So I stick with the old jeans, let the marks plant themselves on my sides, the bright red rings crying and screaming for air. I'll let them linger on my skin until they fade and form again. I hate waistband scars from too tight jeans, but I won't let them go, because time won't let me go, because letting them go won't make the stares dull like old scars. Today, I walked around the park next door wearing my too tight jeans. I let 1,000 new eyes bore into my back. Today, I let time swallow me. My next poem is called Grieving Man. Grieving man, take the coffee cup you left in the sink yesterday and rinse it out. Watch the brown murk and a hint of sugar drip down the drain. Imagine the coffee cup like your sorrow, each day a little cleaner. Grieving man, take the clothes you left on the floor of your bedroom and hang them up. The all-consuming carpet monster of creased shirts and crumpled suit jackets will suddenly become a closet angels before your eyes. Grieving man, picture frames you hide in the drawer beneath your bed hold a key to the sun behind the curtains you leave drawn. If only you would let yourself look, you would find that there's a reason you didn't throw them away. Grieving man, what you tell yourself is not what you are, but your thoughts scream louder than the whispers of the neighbors who have never seen you open your front door. Every time you try, you picture a tunnel between shafts of daylight where desperate people hold their breath and make wishes that never come true. Grieving man, why don't you leave your house? Why don't you walk your dog? She lets herself loose now and always comes back. Trained herself in the way you never could. Sir, where are your kids? Why did you send them away for the summer? Why is your house so eerily quiet that your ears ring? Why is your room dark? Why are your doors closed? Why are there weeds growing up in the jungle of your front yard? You let those weeds have a childhood, so why not your kids? Sir, they tried to talk to you, but you only nodded your head, and so faintly that it might not even have been a nod. Grieving man, it's been 20 years. Why do you still care so much? You're supposed to move on. You're supposed to start over. Wake up. Look at all those envelopes on your empty front porch. If you can't tell yourself, they will. Grieving man, you are the carpet monster. You are the murky liquid of yesterday's coffee. Forget about fixing the sorrow. You are the sorrow. Every black hole, every void you opened in the sheets tangled behind your drawn curtains, you are, you are.
My eyelids when I look too closely at what we've built. Architectural ruin, damp and molding, pillars leaning, will you crumble with me in the night?
I am lost in your attic with all these broken light bulbs I keep finding on your floors. When fear grips me, I crawl into your air vents to sink our breath, but the dust makes me sick. I am making you sick. Wallpaper peeling, your edges curling in my effort to keep warm. I split lips on cracked mugs, but I will remain here. Every morning I try to fix the blinds, and every evening I dwindle our candle supply. One, these days waking looks like spilled ink. My palms are oily with sleep. I swear the crack in the bathroom mirror is getting bigger. Two, I trace the kitchen clock with my fingertip, matching the pace of its languid circles, our hands as if twirling a teaspoon in a ceramic mug, as if satirizing the creation of Adam, hands as if remembering the face of a dream. Three, I kiss the front door with my ear. It's smooth. My heart, limping, drags itself outside to play pretend. The walk to the mailbox is so long. Four, when I drop the glass, it is like I have shattered the day. Shards of noon rain past my knees and hit the ground as dawn. I stoop to sweep the glass with one hand into the other, and upon dumping it in the bin, I slice my hand on morning. Five, maybe it's in the bathwater, this thing eating me, or maybe I'm a cannibal, me, the intestine, I, the tapeworm, the romance of parasitism. Six, none of this is true. I keep trying to write myself in a way you will find beautiful. This isn't a grief I can let you see barefaced. Thank you.
Today we did our digital story project, and then on that placard I wrote, where do I call home? It's actually my mom. So this is a story of my mom and I would love to share with you all. Two people, one market cart. Pillows, clothes, and a pile of textbooks are our belongings. Mom push, four walls roll. The dazzling California sun, soak a threadbare t-shirt, she leads, and I follow her shadow. Here we go again, hapless nomad in the pile of neighborhood. Our market cart has stopped in many locations, and we have lived in many places. An aunt's closet, my stepmother's garage, and many overhangs where we could build a tent under. I will never forget the brief motel stays, and those parking permits they give us for a car. I will want our small market car, and the front desk manager will laugh. Perhaps being a homeless is another thing to laugh at. The narrow sidewalk of our neighborhood will never mean for our market car. My mom will walk on one side, closer to the car line, protecting me on the long shed from one shelter to the next. Sometimes I whine, sometimes I cry. She would stop, listen, and gently encourage me. Until she couldn't. Severe depression gripped her when I was entering high school. The intermediate growing hour work became too much for her. She would spill water from her bucket onto the floor, her trembling hands unable to hold the mold anymore. Each night, she shrank silently to the ground. I had to stand up to make ends meet. I took over my mother's task, cleaning rooms and doing chores for our households before and after school. Hanging a garden, I was reminded of the scars on her hand, bending down to swab a toilet. I recall her struggling to raise her nagging knees when we sat on park bench for too long. My fast track to adulthood was now learned from textbook and seminar style discussions, but by cutting branches and cleaning toilets. I didn't think I was ready for such responsibility. I thought I will always be the child protected by my mother's shadow. But I was driven to work hard to help my mom make ends meet. Perhaps the weight of responsibilities is not about how exhausting the task may be, but about learning to think beyond oneself, beyond myself, more than myself, to consider the needs of my family and community first. Life goes on, and I have many rules along the way. In school, I'm a student. In my family, I'm a son with a mother to support. The four wheels of our trolley still roll, but my mom and I hold the handle together next time. Now, I walk on the side closest to the cars. Thank you so much.
You must first realize it will never get better. Then you must realize what a hypocrite you were forever telling anyone it gets better. This beast hates to be the bearer of bad news, but sometimes it doesn't fucking get better. I still ask the same questions. I'm not even number two. I still try the same things. I will always be behind. This beast still struggles to cry, still finds something wrong with her body, is still alone. For this beast, it will never get better. And the day that this beast accepts that will be the day they will finally be free. Free of this yearning, this longing, this hope for something new, something to change their mind, something to stop the pressure, the bad days, the heartache, the memories of what happened to them. They couldn't get rid of it. They couldn't fix it. They can't fix anything. They can't do anything. This beast just goes back to what they know, hurting themselves, hurting others, making things worse for themselves and everyone else. Part of this beast is okay with the hurt. They are okay with the hurt that they cause. They are too weak to heal, and this beast is tired. And this beast is tired of asking. This beast is tired of messing up. This beast is tired of trying only to be less than. This beast is tired of needing to be fixed. This beast is tired of trying to fix it all. This beast is tired. This beast wants to slumber. This beast isn't actually a poet. They're only a beast who can rhyme. So why are you shaking them? The second poem I have is actually called God is Jealous of Me. I am a sinner, yet God is jealous of me. He is jealous I need no heaven or hell. I only need my beauty, serenity, and blessings I bring to get someone to follow me. God is jealous of me. He is jealous that I did not cause floods that wipe out the entire population I created. I only cause tears of joy to flood from all eyes. God is jealous of me. He is jealous I would have spared the Israelites plagues and enslavement. I would have blown them a kiss. God is jealous of me. He is jealous I do not need to make an example of my people to keep faith aligned. I only need to be authentically me. God is jealous of me. He is jealous I need no angels or prophets to do my bidding. I do it myself. Who can do it better than me? God is jealous of me. He is jealous I would never consider the atrocities he so boldly commits. I'll just be that bitch. God is jealous of me. He is jealous I do not need to have my seal on foreheads to be worshipped. I only need to pout my lips. God is jealous of me. He is jealous I would allow Sodom and Gomorrah redemption. I wouldn't even have to break a sweat. God is jealous of me. He is jealous that I do not need to remove my son from this world and hold him as a trophy to be won when the rapture calls. I am trophy enough. The Lord Almighty is jealous of me. He is jealous that I am a sinner who will never commit these acts of terrorism upon humanity. I will only commit vanity. God is jealous of me. He is jealous that he too is a sinner.
Find in other words, and it ends with, or is it in your next one? A little closer. All right. You put the eyes in chive, eat in threat. You put the hag in chagrin, edge in pledge. You put the oil in counterfoil, the cry in apocryphal, the eon in pigeon, eon in escuchon. In defenestration, the nest, the ratio. You put the imp in limpid, impolite pimple. A dew tornado torn, the lie in lieu, even every reverb. Who comes from a wholesome chowhound? Who whooshes wholesale in blowholes and sawhorses in whirl? So in sooth, your name in gist registers our tournament. You put the other in psychotherapies. You put the ash in quash. In sachet, I ash. You rasp intraspecific. The owl in my snowless lowliness and meadowland. The pit in thy pithy epithet, my cherie glamour in such gaucheries. You dip the end of serendipity in pity, appendages. I put myself in seance. I dilute wine in dilemma, our pour in dilemonade. I put the grin in hungriness, ibis in hibiscus. You put an and amid the eyes of anandamines, evils put to bed, bedevils that lived in and. You fart things in farthingales, a shin too far in publishing. I put the verso in oversoul. I put the small ally in baptismally. In sin, I too sing. Cool. Cool. Chat eschaton. Put that ache in panache. Which egg did you in solfeggio peg? In euphony, hun. Take your own in shallowness. In eiderdown, your own. Do otto and dogleg gap your megaphones. In briefly, your fly end. In duende, your due. Char is in charisma. Nap is already in aromatherapy. You are the one in questioner, in time, with an H, thy ally. Will you rally in like a moth to a mother flicker? You say I am owed in your rodeo. I put the ermine in undetermined, lone clone, king spelunking, asking, where is the end in friend? In lassitude, I sit in situ, my tessitura. I put the stat in apostate, stat in state, air in eclair's lair, pear in herald. Ear led me to the dew in tide waters. You put the stat in gestate. I step at the other end of a stethoscope. In spillover, love, I put the rim of ire in grimoire. In jettison, tis. Scion unconscionable, I put the etch in far-fetched, agog in paragog. I put yes in your fish eyes, Orpheus' pseudocresis. I put no one in none such, yawn in everyone. In the foment, did you read your omen? Then in ash thrashes, ash, this is hard. Then in ash thrashes, the ash unleashed in ash gnashes, ash seashells, ash in stash, ash in pashalings. In curmudgeonly only, if swift, ash and swash, ash mouthwash, ash pea shooters, in flashes unashamed. You put the nail in cannelade, in hostile turnstile. You put the tiny in destiny, sus in census. You've got the nanoseconds in nose, the stall in crystalline. Always with the ears in my tears, each peach gold and augury. I'm me in time, earn in yorn, in joyous ewes. And I got one more. So this is a translation. It's from a book called The Star Child by Theodor Doebler from the German. It's published in 1916. The Star Child refers to a short story, a fable by Oscar Wilde, published maybe 20 years earlier. And the Star Child is a child found in the woods by woodcutters and raised as their own, but the Star Child is conceited, vainglorious. And one day, a beggar woman says, "I am your mother." And the star child says, "No, you're not. You're too ugly." And in that act, he is transfigured. He has become ugly. And people don't like him anymore. And he's exiled. And in exile, he is sold into slavery to a sorcerer. The sorcerer tasks him with finding gold and treasures in the forest. And instead of bringing them back to the sorcerer, some animals help him find the treasures. But each time he gives them to a beggar man on the outskirts of town. And on the last, on the third one, you know, threes and stuff, the beggar man is revealed to be his father. And the spell is broken over his father, who was the king. Of course, the star child is the son of the king, right? And then he takes rule of the nation he was exiled from. He's a good ruler, but he only rules for 3 years before he passes away and is succeeded by an especially cruel ruler, according to Wilde. This is called To the Lost. This is a dramatization of the moment where the star child breaks the spell and recognizes his mother. To the Lost. When your gray eyes animated me, our olive tree was full from lavish dew. To the revival, it sashayed in opaline beaded finery, like sequins silver leaf swarms billowed. As we teased each other with gagged wrinkles, the innocent meadow embodied itself before us. Its mellower morning became vaulted and listless. There it was to be, as if we disguised it in ourselves. Who stood up then? Wordless, we went forward. On the path, dwarf cypresses resembled child heirs of awaited elders, our counterparts. We spoke seldom, then walked on swifter. The saplings stood clear, the path yawned apart. In dust, a beggared, blind sighter flickers. Thanks.
Up next, we have Jossie.
I'm really honored and excited to be with y'all. Y'all are really amazing. And you're being really amazing. And I'm always kind of thanking you at the end of our meetings, but getting up and reading in front of people, even people you've been seeing for upwards of a week, is like a really amazing thing. So thank you for continuing to do the work. You guys are great. I've like an earned spot among y'all. I was telling a group of y'all that I was writing, and it was kind of a sad thing, and then I was telling you guys, a group of y'all, what my thesis was about, and it was also kind of a sad thing, and as Lauren's leaving, she's like, "I told you to write something happy," and I didn't do that, but I remember the last time, that happened, when people were like, "You want to hear about sad stuff?" So this is one of those essays. It's about a stain that was in my the dorm that I went to a lot when I was in college. There was a lounge that had a stain that was really gross. So it's about that, and God, and some other things. ASMR videos. It's called Essay That Was Once Called How to Write About Joy, but my friend said they didn't get the connection, so I don't know, LOL. Was the full title. Me and the homie are sitting on the couch watching a video called Try Not to Be Satisfied. And God knows we ain't failed at yet, despite the fact that every test this land can give us shows us its fangs and drools and rips entire neighborhoods to shreds. But we ain't failed yet. And over by the door, there is a stain oozing out from under the ramp, and the stain is an entire country. It ain't been dry for weeks. The rain don't stop. The flood don't stop. The waters will come to take your kids away along with everything you've built for them. It ain't matter how hard you hold on. And the mold is summoning its divine fungus and establishing colonies and chanting to the gods at this lowered ceiling. But maybe none of that matters right now because someone is building a perfect vase by hand on Alex's laptop screen. And maybe that's all we ask for, the chance to build perfectly or be perfectly built. And Alex's girlfriend comes in and sits down and starts talking about her day, and she is all laughs and smiles pull straight from his chest. And this is the happiest I've seen him since we first met in this dorm lounge, 30 feet off the ground, surrounded by Yu-Gi-Oh cards and a thick night sky, and enough grief between the two of us to take us away. A thick night sky and enough grief between the two of us to take us away. The rain don't stop, the flood don't stop. The only perfect thing the water has ever built was the crater I carved myself out of. And last night, I had a dream where I was kissed by someone I haven't seen in a very long time. And then we just kept kissing. And the man I drove across town on an empty tank of gas to eat ice cream with once said, "Once you know what it is to be lonely, it is hard to unsee that which serves as a reminder that you were not always." And this man is not Alex, or my father, or anyone I've lived with. This man is a poet that I did not know 3 years ago, and who now knows me well enough to eat ice cream with me, and I'm still alive and blessed. And watching Alex kiss his girlfriend with the kind of joy we once reserved for the parts of ourselves we thought that we would never see again. And the stain is still expanding and sopping and threatening rot. And suddenly, three men come in with tools and belts and all kinds of answers. And one of them looks at the stain and its constant evolution of mold and says, "Holy hell." And the second guy squints at me and asks if we've met before, and we haven't, so I say, "No, I don't think so." And he says, "Huh, you must have that kind of face." And I've been called many things by strangers, but never familiar. And the third guy leaves. And back in the day, a dude named Paul wrote a letter to a dude named Timothy and said to cry false teachers and help the widows and give yourself wholly to them so that they may see your progress. And maybe he was talking about leading a church, or maybe he was talking about the Holy Ghost being the only thing worth surrendering to, or maybe he was talking about the way a river of honey kisses a plate and disappears back into itself as it lays fat flat. But regardless, me and Alex are 7 minutes into this video, and we still haven't failed yet. The rain don't stop, the flood don't stop. The water makes a soldier out of all who survive it. Or maybe not. Maybe the flood is just the flood and the rain is just the rain. But before I can make up my mind, the third guy comes back in with a machine and a hose and starts gathering the stained stagnant offering and throwing it into the kind of tornado that you can pick up and take with you. And I've always preferred to call it the Holy Ghost, because nothing divine is never haunted. And Alex's laptop is now over on my side of the couch, and his girlfriend is sitting on his lap, and their eyes are closed, and they're holding each other with the kind of tenderness that makes you realize that you are lonely, but you were not always. And it isn't awkward in any sense of that word or any other. And the second guy is talking to the first guy, even though no one can hear anything over the tornado's violent conquering of that which the stain defiled for so long and learned to call it home. The rain don't stop, the flood don't stop, the water makes a fist around every atom of sanctuary and dares the universe to let it go. But the tornado is winning, even if it has to cross the lake several times. And Alex and his girlfriend look like they're trying to build a cocoon out of complete stillness and the lack of space between them. And 8 minutes into the video, petals of white sugar bloom on a cupcake, and it is perfect. And maybe grief is a kind of flower, maybe everything is a rainbow, maybe sadness isn't always just sadness. And Paul wrote Timothy all of those letters because he was an apostle born out of due time, a homie late to the party but still not satisfied. And he missed his friend. They nailed him to the kind of tree that you can pick up and take with you, and they made him cross an entire country just to get to the hill that he was destined to die on, and they killed him while his mother watched and wept. And my mom weeps sometimes. My mom crosses entire countries just to see that I am still alive and blessed. And there are hills I haven't even seen. But then again, I've never saved anything but my dinner for the next day. So maybe that makes us even. And even when he was being killed, he gave himself wholly to them so that they might see his progress. And he screamed, "Forgive them, Father, they know not what they do." And I don't know what I do or how I'm still doing. And I just woke up one day watching a country disintegrate while two people built a silent monument to the only force worth surrendering to. The rain don't stop, the flood don't stop, the water only uses the word love when it is absolutely necessary. And maybe grace is something that you can never internalize, but the stain is now a damp echo, scarring the carpet, and the video is over, and asking if we want to watch it again. And Alex asked me if I want to join them for lunch, and I say sure. Thank you.
I'll be reading two pieces. This first piece is about growing up and out of girlhood. The only way to bury a girl is feet first. Because if she can't run, she'll have nothing to do with her hands. The first handful of dirt will be easiest, but the second will hurt. By the time she's waist deep, your palms will sear and sizzle. Close her mouth on the way down, but leave her eyes open. Take the ribbon out of her hair, the glasses off her face, the bracelets off her wrists. Take whatever won't rot and bury the rest. Unclench her fist, straighten her back. Hold the nape of her neck as you lean over her. Make sure her head doesn't fall forward. And if she weeps, weep with her, but don't wipe her tears. Let her know what it is to ache one last time. Because after the last grains of dirt fall on her head, know you are the next to inhabit this grave. Wash your hands with the warm black soil, the earth opening her soft mouth under your feet. This one is called The Geography of a Blank Page. The day she starts tearing roses out of the flower bed, I take her down to the river to watch the cranes. She asks me why the sky is blue when I tell her to skip or walk across the water. The cranes scatter across the surface, dissolve like seafoam, ash white, stark against the marshy shore. Of course, she tries to seize the ripples, and of course, her hand comes away filled with milky stones. She asks me how to tell the difference between a live fish and a dead dog, and I told her to close her fist, look for the ghost of the river in the contours of the cool stone. Eventually, she peels her fingers open and crabs burrowing into the soft white meat of her palm. This is how to make a home, I say. Bullshit, she says. The remnants of sun dripping down the trees exhaling into the evening. After dark, we pull weeds from the pits of our elbows and leave them on the riverbank. By morning, they'll have been swallowed whole and spat out somewhere else. The cranes return to the water with fresh blood in their scarlet brows. It's a little like starting over, I say. She asks me why it matters, and I tell her it doesn't.
So this one is sort of, I guess I shouldn't explain it. It's called Dollhouse Blues. Please, let me explain myself. To be human is to be beholden to others. Obligations are the core driving force behind most life. From the moment we are born, we are expected to do something, even just live. And somebody's well-being is dependent on that. When my parents were alive, they were the only people I needed to interact with, but not to my detriment. My mother and father were everything guardians should be. Disciplined, kind, patient, generous. All they wanted from me was to see my growth, nurture me so that they could see me blossom. Between the two, I had enough company for several lifetimes, but that only made it harder when they passed. Their absence was as much a force in my life as their presence. The lack of support pressed against me like an anvil on my chest until I collapsed in on myself. I know you understand what I mean. I know you have the others ripped away from you so violently when they had just patched up the holes in your life. I know the destruction of those patches widened the holes that had just been hidden, so they combined into one yawning, infinite abyss. What do you do then? You can't walk around with that gaping wound, not in this reality that will use it to drain you of everything. Just listen. Stay with me. We can use the remnants of them, make it so they're still here. The messes they left, stains from spilled juice, shattered ceramic and glass, holes in the drywall from the pictures torn from it. They're still here. We don't have to clean it up.
Non-writer here, so just gonna sing.
That's okay. We believe in you!
Thank you. You all made me so emotional that I was just thinking of whether I should sing or not. But yeah, I'll try.
Let's see.
Can you hear that music? Sometimes
morning. Is this a good volume for everybody?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to be reading a poem I wrote called The Undeniable Brittany May.
Yeah.
There once was a girl who was 7 years old, a girl who would watch until the wind would hold. She would grab her mace, follow men home, and take the hair from their comb. Her name was Brittany May, and she'd often lead boys astray with her bewitching good looks. Oh, why was Brittany May such a crook? The word on the street was that Brittany would eat the men who did her wrong until their bodies were all gone. Some say Brittany May would take men home, let them sip on a drink until their mouths foam, painted their bodies in nothing but teal, sat back, relaxed, and enjoyed her meal. The question still is asked to this day, why, oh why, was Brittany Bay, why, oh why, did Brittany Bay act this way? Some say her father did what no father should do, something a little girl should never have to go through. Some say the first love of her life threw her away and ran back to his wife. Today, Brittany Bay found a man, but alas, this man was not a fan. He took his drink, splashed in Brittany's face, and killed her with her own mace. That's the tale of Brittany Bay, who would lead men astray and feast on them in the night, in the woods, under the moonlight. But tonight, on the 3rd of June, under the waxing gibbous moon, a man took her life by the name of Gage Gold, and in his arms laid a dead Brittany Bay cold.